There is a new book which is exploring the Hobbit's Upper South Island locations, and it's out on the market today. New Zealand's expert in all things Middle Earth, one Ian Brodie, has written and illustrated this Hobbit location guidebook. It includes the Pelorus River site in Marlborough and several sites in the Nelson and Golden Bay regions. It's called the Hobbit Motion Picture Trilogy Location Guidebook. Its official launch has been in Wellington just a short time ago, and Ian Brodie is with us now. I think he's about to head off to Havelock North. Hello there, Ian. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Simon.
Nice to have you along. Sounds like the rich vein of interest in all things related to Tolkien has not gone away.
Oh, it's going to stay, I think, forever. Ever since the Lord of the Rings films came out, New Zealand was indelibly stamped, I think, as Middle Earth. And that's just been reaffirmed, of course, with the Hobbit film trilogy. And I think the exciting thing is with the Hobbit film trilogy, all new locations except one, so different places to what we saw in New Zealand portrayed as Middle Earth and Lord of the Rings.
Right. Now, just before we get on to that, I'm bound to ask you a little bit more, if I may, Ian, about this, the interest, because you might think, after all these years, that there's perhaps a little fatigue which might have set in, but you're not detecting any of that?
I see no fatigue at all, and certainly people visiting this country from overseas are so exposed to Middle Earth as a place that is now New Zealand. And I guess the only way I can look at it is my Lord of the Rings location guidebooks. They've been out now for 10 years. We're not seeing any drop in numbers of sales. And in fact, we're up over the 400,000 mark, and that's continuing. So I think that proves certainly that for overseas visitors, New Zealand is Middle Earth.
And are they buying them mainly here, or are you actually selling overseas?
The Lord of the Rings book is mainly sold here, so they're arriving in New Zealand and buying the book when they get here. The Hobbit location guidebook is different. That's been released worldwide as of the next few days, so that can be purchased through all those online outlets, the Amazons and Barnes and Nobles of this world, and all those sorts of things.
All right, so tell me about this, the new book. And as you say, there are new locations, right?
Yes, there is. This book covers all the locations used in the films, and that's from Hobbiton movie set in the north. Denise Bluffs by Pew Pew, absolutely amazing place, just out of Tikawiti, which portrayed the Troll Shores. And then we go right through the rest of the North Island, top of the south, as you mentioned, and then all the way down to Te Anau, Fiordland, and that area as well. So this book features all those locations. But my love is New Zealand, I guess, but it also is the love of travelling New Zealand. So this book is, even for those that maybe have a passing interest in the film, have seen it once, wondered where that place is, this book will guide you there. You don't have to be a fan. It's just a beautiful place to visit. But at the same time, I suggest, I guess, my favourite place is to eat, to stay, and enjoy this country.
Okay, so just to do the research, what did you actually do?
Well, Simon, it was a really tough job.
Somebody had to do it.
I spent 6 weeks with my daughter in tow, and we travelled New Zealand.
But in terms of matching the location with the scene in the films, and also being able to tell a story about how, you know, what happened on that location and how it translates on the cinema, it sounds like you might have had to do some collaboration with the people who made the film.
Oh, most certainly. This is an official guidebook, for want of a better word. So it's endorsed by, and I worked with Warner Brothers, and of course 3Foot7 to produce the book. So the location scouts for the films, they helped me with all the locations. They explained exactly what angles were used. And of course the book is illustrated with film stills from the film. So you can match up what you see in real life and what you saw in one of those films.
And how, just to know what people say when they go to the actual site, Ian, because although the films obviously take advantage of the natural beauty of our landscape, in part there is some elaboration through CGI and the like. So, you know, to what extent are people saying, oh, it was sort of like that, or it's exactly like that? You know, what sort of comments do you get from people?
Well, I certainly, the way I put it, Simon, is to say, before the films came out, you read Lord of the Rings, you read The Hobbit, you created these landscapes in your mind. That is what you need to do when you go to visit the actual place. There might not be a Minas Tirith. There might not be something on the side of the Lonely Mountain, but that doesn't matter because use your imagination. That's what Tolkien did so brilliantly in his writing, was describing places. And that, for me, is seeing this beautiful landscape and imagining what was there.
And in your mind, when you were reading The Hobbit, you obviously pictured locations. Now that you've seen what's been done in the films, what do you make of the choices they've made?
Well, it surpasses my expectations. You're right. When I first read Lord of the Rings way back when I was 14, I pictured New Zealand and I came up with places in my mind. Having seen the films and now The Hobbit, they've chosen places that I thought, yes, that's perfect, places that I thought, wow, I would never have thought that because I've never been there. Now I have, and I can see why you chose it. It's just perfect.
Now, I mentioned in the introduction, Ian, the Pelorus River.
Yes.
Where does that feature in the film?
That's in the second film, and the elves have captured the dwarves and one very lonely hobbit, I guess, by that stage, that the dwarves have to get out. They want to get to the Lonely Mountain. So they Bilbo saves the day. He pushes them into the barrels down in the vineyard part of the elven headquarters, I guess you'd say, and they end up floating down the river. And, of course, that river in the film is the Pelorus River. There's a couple of other scenes as well over at the Aoriri River. And that's one thing that the filmmakers are very clever at, is taking places that geographically in New Zealand might be quite far apart, but have the same geographical features. So in one minute you can be down on the west coast of the South Island by Punakaiki, but then you can also shift up to Aoriri, the Salisbury Falls, or you can go back across to the Pelorus River. The landscape looks the same, so seamlessly in the film it's joined together.
Of the locations that you've visited, and you've obviously visited them all, do you have one that's your favourite?
Well, I have a few, I guess, but certainly Denise Bluffs at Pew Pew in the North Island is a fantastic place to visit. They're now running tours through that location, and it's an eye-opener to a part of New Zealand. I would suggest not a lot of New Zealanders, or certainly people from overseas, have ever visited.
Well, describe it for us, Ian.
It's a huge, big cliff. So if you can imagine driving up a valley with these towering cliffs on each side of you, almost alien-looking because of the limestone cragginess of them, and you reach the Troll Shores, Denise Bluffs, it's this twisted landscape of rock with beautiful native New Zealand bush, but above you are these limestone landscape formations. It's like you've been transported to an alien world.
And has that location already featured in the two films to date, or is that still to come in the third film?
It featured in the first film. It's the Troll Shores, where the dwarves, Gandalf and the Hobbit, are working their way across to Rivendell, and they arrive at a farmhouse that's been devastated by these nasty trolls.
Oh, yes. Okay,
and
gotcha.
Subsequently, the dwarves are captured and are going to be roasted or minced up or any other sort of very foul way of cooking dwarves.
Right. Yes. Now, you've been in Wellington today. I think you're travelling. Are you actually getting around the country again to promote this book?
Yes, I am. And I was very fortunate last night to be here in Wellington and to talk to the media group, I guess, that travelled with the 150 prize winners that Warner Brothers Tourism New Zealand and Air New Zealand brought out here. The group of 150 got to see the movie. I guess I got second prize and got to talk to the media, but that was a fantastic night. They all were given a copy of the book to take home with them. And tomorrow I head off to Havelock. And a friend of mine there is part of a gallery, the Havelock Gallery. And tomorrow night we're launching the book there again. And I'm just giving a talk about New Zealand film tourism and all those sorts of things.
Okay. A lot of debate about how much money we should be spending, you know, taxpayers' money making it easier for films to be made here and spending promoting these films as a way of attracting visitors to New Zealand? Obviously, you'd be on the side of spending as much as possible.
Well, I talk a lot overseas at film tourism conferences, and one of the calculations I did a few years ago, and this is before The Hobbit, was that about $140 million per annum was spent in New Zealand by tourists coming here because of the Lord of the Rings film trilogy. Now, through the figures that Tourism New Zealand have provided, we can certainly see that The Hobbit has brought a significant increase in numbers. So again, that number of dollars will only increase as well. But yes, I'm on that side, obviously.
Yes. I want to ask you one other thing, I'm sure you're going to give me a very honest answer. One of the comments I often hear from people when discussing the adaptation of The Hobbit is how the filmmakers have taken material from appendices and brief references in a very short book and turned it into a three-film story. And I know some people have enjoyed it, but they think, is that just going a touch too far in terms of making too much of a short story? What do you think?
Well, I first read Lord of the Rings, not The Hobbit, and The Lord of the Rings just captured my imagination. I then devoured the appendices because I wanted to know more. I wanted to know about the White Council. What did happen before the ring was found? I then read The Hobbit, and that was the perfect lead, I guess, to the appendices. So, in my opinion, all we're seeing is The Hobbit as the book was presented, but we are seeing these wonderful appendices that Tolkien wrote to, I guess, tell the story even further, to develop that story. Because in reality, if you look the way Tolkien wrote The Hobbit, he wrote it for his children. It was a totally different style of book to The Lord of the Rings. But by the end of The Hobbit, that darker side was coming through. So the filmmakers have taken all those factors into account, and I believe have created a truly amazing story of Tolkien's world.
Ian, thank you very much, and good luck with the book. Ian, with us today, Ian Brodie, and he's responsible for this new book called The Hobbit Motion Picture Trilogy Location Guidebook.